Welcome to Care Talk at Health 2019, a special interview series here at the Health Innovation Conference in Las Vegas. We're interviewing special guest John Brownstein today.
Our first victim.
Yeah, he is Chief Innovation Officer at Boston Children's Hospital and a professor at Harvard Medical School. John, thanks for joining us.
It's great to be here, guys.
So John, I know that you're kind of known for technology insight and you're an expert in epidemiology. But you're also Canadian, so is the Canadian system better than the U.S.?
Yeah, I mean, listen, it's a complicated question, right? Because everyone has access, but if you talk to my parents or my family members, they look at the ability for us to access specialists in, you know, immediately in the Boston ecosystem. That is not uniform across the country, of course, so we have so much variability in terms of access. So for those who have access, it is much better than the Canadian system. You're not waiting months for an appointment.
But you've got kind of Harvard-level access.
Right, so it's hard.
Gold card.
Right, but if you think about, you know, for the average person, I mean, right, the Canadian system is working much better for you.
Now, from an innovation perspective, how do our systems compare? Because you're the Chief Innovation Officer
right.
of Boston.
So that's the other thing. There is a lot more resource to do cool, cutting-edge things in the U.S. than in Canada. My counterparts, I mean, there is no chief innovation officer at a hospital in the top-tier hospitals in Canada. It just doesn't exist. There's not a lot of effort, but at the end of the day, access to your medical information is much easier. There's a lot more interoperability.
Really?
So there's a lot
more.
You've
got the data, they just don't use it?
Yeah, but John, the thing is, if you have an innovation officer, it's sort of like, you know, Ford used to have a VP of quality.
Yeah.
You know, Toyota didn't have a VP of quality.
Right.
Like, innovation is what you need, like, if you don't have innovation in the organization.
Yeah, so don't take this personally, but often when there's a chief
innovation officer, take it as a professional
insult. It's a place where you put innovation to go and die.
Yeah, exactly. Trust me. It's a complicated title for me. It's one that I have to be very careful of because it can be labeled as just like a pure evangelist. Like, you're just at conferences like this, speaking, but are you actually getting anything done in your organization?
It's like chief instigation officer.
Or chief, like a marketing person, figurehead that's not really doing anything.
But let's give you credit. I love the idea that you sort of helped kind of create this using what people call digital exhaust.
Yeah.
They're really kind of digital signals
of
bringing kind of public health back in, leveraging data. Can you talk a little bit about
sure.
it? Because that still strikes me as we're still at early stages of leveraging big data, really data,
so
to drive public health stuff.
My background is in public health. Always was very frustrated with the lack of data availability. So you could get some data out of a clinical system, but if you really wanted to understand the health of a population or like at a national scale, you can't do that with clinical data. Yet there's all this like digital exhaust, so information that comes through social networks, through what you search for online, what your Fitbit is reading about you. If you can collect that information, harness it, categorize it, filter, you can get important population signals that you can never have gotten. And so we've done this in infectious disease, in sleep disorders, we're doing this in the opioid epidemic. We just wrote a paper last week in New England Journal of Medicine where we actually were able to track the vape lung problem based on our search patterns of data online. And that was something that, you know,
online versus actual clinical data, really?
And we've been able to show over and over that this data is incredibly valuable for us to understand what's happening in a population.
John, you've gone beyond trying to innovate within Children's or within Harvard and actually launched a couple companies.
Yeah.
How does that work? What have you done?
Yeah, so, you know, I guess the idea of being at Harvard an entrepreneur is not something that...
A Harvardpreneur.
You know, unlike what MIT was doing where there was this acceptance of being able to build commercial companies, the idea that your academic product could actually turn into something that scales and matters is a hard thing. So I launched a company about actually close to 10 years ago that was in the data mining space, trying to give government agencies insights about what was happening with disease outbreaks, sold that company, and then started another company called Circulation, which is in the transportation space, and try to figure out how to deal with this important social determinant, which is access to transportation, by bringing in modern transportation options like Uber and Lyft into health systems that help get patients to appointments and help them get home.
What's the barrier there, John? Because it just seems so obvious. And we were involved in taking care of folks at CareCentrix and trying to solve that last mile.
Yeah.
And some of the reasons things break down are not availability. It's connection, connecting and collaborating with patients around things like food and transportation.
Absolutely.
What are the barriers? Because obviously Lyft and Uber have transformed transportation in general. Mm-hmm. What are the barriers to kind of bring those same kind of innovations to healthcare?
Right. I mean, I think the reality is it's all about, unfortunately, interoperability. you know, we've actually
had... pull that back. What does that mean?
Well, in our
Everybody's own, got a phone.
Yeah, right. But if you're going to try to book or transport a ride for a patient through your health system, you have to create a direct connection between your electronic medical record and the booking process to make it seamless, or else nobody's going to use it. Yeah. So you could have a phone, you could open an app and book it, but there's really, that really presents a problem. And our EMR vendors have spent a lot of time trying to open up APIs and create...
Sort of.
They've made claims of it, but the proportion of, say...
Those big castles in Game of Thrones.
I was going to say, how big does your booth have to be in order to talk a big interoperability game?
Right, I know, exactly. Unfortunately,
there's some sort of correlation Can you do some of that data gathering around here? Like size of booth relative to level of something.
Of interoperability, right, exactly. So that is still, you know, the number one challenge. And it's the number one challenge for not only, like, transportation, all the startups we're building.
But how much of that is a question of technology versus just an unwillingness to collaborate? You know, for us, at least, it... CareCentrics, we talk a lot about how healthcare is a team sport, but it's undermined by individual incentives.
Yeah, so for sure.
If you paid them to provide that interoperability, would that help?
Possibly. I mean, listen, there's government mandates now that are put some sort of pressure to do this.
So the fire standard.
Yeah, fire standard. But
.2.
Of all our elements in the EMR, only 10% are mapped to fire. So like every time, so every time we try to bring a startup, everybody thinks they can do fire. It's still not at a point where we have a seamless ability to do this. Now, we're trying to build sort of that API layer through other startups that are trying to do a better job of creating that ecosystem of apps, but it's hard. It's taking time, and, you know, we'll see. Like,
speak to the fire standard and why so many people are excited about it? Because it seems like it's a game changer.
It's a game changer because people have coalesced around a very specific set of standards that, you know, finally there's some level of agreement. It's not very hard to convert sort of your existing elements to fire, but you just need to put the time in. And because every clinical environment is highly customized, you can't just do it one time. You've got to do it, you know, for every health system has to sort of invest in this, unfortunately.
Each one?
I mean, there's things that are overlapping, but there's so much and this is actually for us our biggest issue, which is we're trying to get out of the high customized environment that we're supporting.
Yeah.
And there's the 80-20 rule, and, you know, we should be trying to be more standardized across our organization and across other deployments of, like, Cerner and Epic. And, you know about this.
Well, I know about it, but our viewers don't know everything. Yeah. They know more than we do, but not everything. So John, what are we doing in Las Vegas? You see anything around here you want to interoperate with?
I mean, there are a lot of
startups.
Other
than, like, the slot machine?
Well, we have a whole pavilion here on voice technology, and that's an area that we've been spending a lot on.
Why? But there's an enormous interest in voice as a super application, as a new super
Especially
app.
Your voice, John.
Well, we're trying to reduce yours.
Why
are people so excited about voice? Why is that the killer app?
Okay, there's a couple reasons. One, we keep pushing our patients, our clinicians, more and more technology, but it's made their lives more complicated, right?
Actually.
Hell. But if you think about
it. Physician burnout is down, physician suicide is up, caregiver burnout's up. It's a real challenge now.
So we've built these technologies that push more forms and more documentation. So then you think about the advent, we have portals and mobile apps, it's all the same crap. But then now you think about voice and chatbot-like tools, it changes the name of the game in terms of interaction with technology. It's much more natural. It works right out of the box.
I mean, we can get rid of some of this paper?
Well, that's what I think. I mean, and there's a bunch of companies that are...
Say it isn't so.
No, but can extract the conversation that happens between a provider and a patient, extract the important elements, populate it in EHR. Imagine you can have a natural conversation with a provider because these technologies are working in the background.
Well, I think people don't realize how much is available right now with sentiment analysis.
Yeah.
You can put a chatbot in place. Yeah. Again, at our company, we're just putting in some of those listening technologies that immediately start to cue the caregiver or the care provider or the problem who's trying to solve to where the patient is.
Well, I believe that firmly. And then there's a whole field of vocal biomarkers that are looking for slight changes in volume, rate, rhythm, patterns in your voice that you don't even know that could be indications of mental illness, infectious disease, sleep disorders, cardiovascular events.
So, John, can someone run that? Can they just actually put this through the podcast machine and say, well, right, diagnose John finally?
You might have a lot of problems. Yeah, you sure you want to go, there?
It's worth it for it to hear what's wrong with John.
Mental illness kind of one of those filters, David?
Get rid of the stigma, John. Leave me alone.
I agree with getting rid of the stigma. I'm not going to leave you alone.
All right. What else are we going to pound, John,
well,
on
today? I think that one of the things that I thought was interesting is in your career, yeah. at least with the way I read it, you really constructed some really exciting yeah. things about public health threats.
Right.
Ebola,
yeah.
cholera,
yeah.
Zika.
Yeah.
But that struck me as early stage yeah. kind of sort of looking at what could you pull out of public yeah. data sets without having to go through the all of the silos of current healthcare
yes.
data. What else can we do with current large open data sets
yeah.
to teach us about, to return the public yeah. to public health, the way you're
yeah.
talking about?
I mean, there's lots of opportunities. So we've done a lot of data mining, but the reality is, like, if we can do better engagement of the population in their own health, you're better off. Like, we spent a lot of time scraping things like Twitter and Facebook over the years, but that's not really...
Productive or not?
It's been very productive. It's given us insights, like on things like,
just
I don't know.
Just make sure to exclude John's Twitter feed
yeah,
from that
right.
list.
It's
going to throw off
some outliers.
So like we got yeah. important insights of like, you know, vaccine confidence. Like we could track rumors around vaccines, try to figure out how to prevent sort of like insurgence against, you know, the flu shot or whatever it is. So you can get important real sentiment, but the problem is it's not really feeding back to individuals. So we've now, like, we've built a number of different crowdsourcing tools that then get important insights. Like, we run a project called Flu Near You, which tracks flu epidemics through people's self-report. We actually
That's very powerful.
It's very powerful. Then we launch what I think is our most popular website that you probably have never heard of called streetrx.com. And basically what we do there...
I know, that's where John gets his heroin.
No, opium.
That's where he prices it, excuse me.
And then he has the heroin. Yeah. And basically we track the price fluctuation of every black market purchase.
How do you get access to
people
that information?
People report it. People
really?
Give us that data in
yeah,
huge
job.
Volume. And so we know every prescription drug on the street is worth at any given time in any geography. Other people come in and then decide whether they got a good or a bad deal, so we can remove outliers of people gaming the system. Huge insights that we're getting that we then feed to our government agencies to understand what, you know, new drugs are mm-hmm. sort of taking hold in a population, getting real world data. Now, I think to your point, how do you start to feed that back to do a better job at the clinical level
yeah.
to give, you know, and that's still something that we've been working on. How do you take this sort of unstructured, non-conventional data and bring it back into the practice of medicine? And that's still something.
Is there a little bit of bias against using unstructured information from outside the holy silo
totally,
of healthcare?
Totally, yeah. I mean, there's definitely people that would think that that's completely useless data.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of good evidence that shows, like, your interaction with your mobile phone gives you important insights, like, you know, how fast you're texting, your sentiment. That could be an indication to a professional that maybe you need to, like, step in mm-hmm. or maybe change your course of treatment. So we're slowly getting there, but there's still, you know, a couple silos that exist here.
So, John, last question. What are we going to see in the next 2 or 3 years? What are you most
yeah.
excited about there?
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, I hate to go back to sort of this opening up of the electronic medical record and, you know, what's going to happen in
How
terms
much
of data
but
flow.
But you're kind of waiting for Godot there. I mean, is
well,
that going to happen?
We're waiting for some
it's
big...
Godot.
Some big transformation to occur.
Yeah.
You know, that's an area that for us opens up, because like I could list off 50 different projects and efforts that we think are exciting, are going to be transformational,
yeah.
new technologies that are taking hold. But if we don't figure that part out, we're going to have, we just can't really get anywhere. And so that's
on that optimistic note.
Yeah.
Great.
Well, but we're having a lot of fun.
Thank
we're
you,
actually
yeah.
we're having a ton of fun. Yes.
Well, there is more data,
yeah.
and you want to, but you want to provide yeah. the information from the system
yes.
to help the system heal itself.
Exactly.
But it also is a call to action.
Right.
We have to actually knock down those
right.
walls.
Otherwise, we're still going to have these. They're separate, like, clinical environments, and then all these cool startups here that are collecting incredible patient level data that are basically going nowhere. So, yeah.
Well, thank you, John Brownstein. Professor at Harvard Medical School. I'm trying to count if he's doing these
serial
things at the same time. I was going to say whether he's serial or parallel entrepreneur, depending on how many things are happening. In any case, we are here, my co-host John Driscoll, CEO of CareCentrics, and me, David Williams, from Health Business Group at Health 2019. You can see the entire series of interviews that we're
All
doing
of
for
them.
Health 2019 on your YouTube playlist.
You have
or listen.
A lot of time on your hands.
You can listen wherever you like to listen to podcasts. And remember, subscribe to Care Talk so you never miss another episode.
All of you need to subscribe.
Do it.
Hey there, listeners. Want more Care Talk? There's more to be had in our other episodes, so be sure to look for those and subscribe to Care Talk on your favorite service.